The delay by k-sample block is used. It is indicated like this. Over here, Z is to minus K is indicated. That means whenever to the input this block is given, it will delay the input signal by K samples. That means here, as you can see, X of N is applied to Z is to minus K block. So at the output side, what we will get? We will get the delayed input. That means X of N minus K. Same way, if I want to advance it by K sample, I will put the block Z is to plus K, which will add the input signal, or else advance the input signal by K samples. So this is how you can get the X of N plus K value. So this is the table indicated the block diagram and signal flow diagram representations for linear constant coefficient difference equations. Now, let us see advantages of representing the digital filter in block diagram form. That means why we need to represent any digital filter or any digital system in block diagram form, and what are the advantages for that. So the first advantage is that just by observing the block diagram, the computation algorithm can be easily written. That means whenever there is large computation algorithms are there, when you represent it in the block diagram form, it becomes easier to perform the steps and to get the output system according to the function. Second advantage is that from the block diagram, the relationship between input and output can be determined. That means just by showing at the pictorial or block diagram representation of the signal, you can get the idea that what are the input signals and what are the output signals, and how output is dependent to the input signal, and what is the function for that. The third advantage is that the memory requirement and the computation complexity can be determined using block diagram structure. That means what are the memory requirement block, what are the size for that, and what is the computational complexity that may occur while establishing the digital filter. That can also be judged using the block diagram structure. The fourth advantage is that from the transfer function, variety of equivalent block diagram representation can be determined. That means from the block diagram, if we determine the transfer function, the representation or behavior of similar functions can also be determined. So these are the advantages of representing the digital filter in block diagram form. So it is beneficial to represent any function or any system function in block diagram. Now, next is canonic and non-canonic structure. So what is the difference between canonic and non-canonic structure? So whenever the order of the system function is similar to that of the delay blocks in any of the system function or block diagram representation, that structure is referred to as the canonic structure. And on the other side, whenever the delay samples are different to that of the order of the system function, it is called as the non-canonic structure. Let's say, for example, if I have the order of the system function, which is minus 2, right? That means Z is to minus 2 is there in some particular system function or differential equation. Let's say, for example, the whole equation is Z is to minus 2 plus 2Z is to minus 1 plus 1. So here the maximum order is what? 2, or else you can say minus 2. If in the structure there are exactly two delay elements, that means, let's say, for example, it may be your Z is to minus 1 or Z is to minus 1 and total of Z is to minus 2 power. Two delay element blocks are there. This referred to as the canonic structure. Otherwise, it is referred to as the non-canonic structure. Okay? Now, next, structures of IIR systems. Now, there are basically two types of structures in direct form. Then the another one is cascaded form structure, in which we have single structure. And the another third one is parallel form structure, again in which there is single form structure. That means the total of three types of structures are there for IIR system. The first one is direct form structure, the second one is cascaded form structure, and the third one is parallel form structure. We will see the examples for each of the structures and how to plot them in detail. Let us see the first one, direct form structure. So in direct form structure, there are two types. There is, again, it is divided into two types. First one, it is called as direct form one structure, and the second one is called as direct form two structure. Now let us see the example of representing the system function, and which is given as h of z, which is equals to summation of k equals to 0 to n vk into z raised to minus k divided by 1 plus summation of k equals to 1 to n ak z raised to minus k. Now what is the difference of direct form 1 structure and direct form 2 structure? That we'll understand using this equation. So this is the standard system function representation, which is h of z. Now let us take the numerator part, which is called as all zero system, as h1 of z, and denominator part, which is called as all pole system, as h2 of z. So whenever in this case, if I take the numerator part, that is h1 of z, which is equals to numerator, which is summation of k equals to 0 to m vk into z raised to minus k, and if I take h2 of z, that will be equals to 1 upon 1 plus summation of k equals to 1 to n ak z raised to minus k. Whenever I take h1 of z this and h2 of z by representing all zeros and all pole system differently, and then if I multiply this to get the h of z, that means h of z, that will be equals to h1 of z into h2 of z. And if I represent the individual systems like this to get a finer structure h of z, this is referred to as the direct form 1 structure. Now reverse case, that means all zero systems are considered as h2 of z and all pole systems are considered as h1 of z, that means reverse to that of this, that will be referred to as the direct form 2 structure. Okay, we will see by using examples what is the difference between these two and which one is more beneficial and why to use direct form 1 structure or direct form 2 structure according to the system. Now let's see next one, which is cascaded form structure. Now cascaded form structure, it is also sometimes referred to as the series form structure, because in this what happens is whenever there is a system function given to you, it is divided into the part, that means there is not required to take the part all zero system or all pole systems, nothing like that. You can take the combined numerator and denominator part, or you can divide according to the requirement to make the final system function, which is given as h of z, that is equals to h1 of z into h2 of z into h3 of z into up to hn of z. That means whatever the number of systems you are taking, whenever you are multiplying this or you are obtaining a series connection for that, it is referred to as the cascaded form structure. That means here h1 of z can be the equation in terms of numerator and denominator as well. Same way h2 of z can be in terms of this, or h3 of z can be only all pole system or all zero system likewise. But using this, whenever you are placing this in a series form, it is referred to as the cascaded form structure. Also, we will understand this by using example. Now, next is parallel form structure. Now, in parallel form structure, it is referred to as the method in which we are going to use the PAP method, which we have seen in the Z transform chapter. That means in this what happens is by using PFE method, that means partial fraction expansion method, we will find the constant values, and so that we can represent the system function as h of z, which is equals to c plus h1 of z plus h2 of z up to hn of z, or else whatever the number systems are there. Here c represents the constant value obtained from the partial fraction expansion method, and the others are the other values of differential equations for LTI systems, or as you can say, differential equations for the rest of the system. Okay, so using this we will obtain the parallel form structure, which will be represented in terms of parallel structure. Okay, so the previous one was series structure, this is the parallel form structure. But to obtain the parallel form structure, we are going to use the partial fraction expansion method to get all the equation in terms of addition term. Okay, so these are the basic three forms for the structures of IIR systems. In the next session, we will see each of the structures using the example, how to draw the structures and what are the system requirements for this in detail. These are the references for this presentation. Thank you. Thank you for listening.